What happened in the generation of the destruction? What was so bad? If you look inside, you see that even the prophets, they didn't know why Hashem did all this. Everybody was well keeping the Torah, tefillin, going to mikveh, keeping everything that you want. So why? What happened? What went wrong? And Hashem says, nobody knew the answer, only Hashem. And Hashem says, Al ozvam et Torati, because they left my Torah. So now you have to know, there is a Torah, and there is a Torah of Hashem. It's two different things. You know what went on there? You all know already the Gemara Begitin Bar Kamtza and Bar Kamtza, right? What was hiding behind all this? A person got embarrassed in public, and so many people were there. No one, not even one, to stand for his defense, not even one. They all were busy eating. Somebody is killing somebody else with his words. And the other people are saying, what a food, delicious food. What are you saying? That's how the generation looked. The problem was, and it's until today, I have to tell it to you, you can say whatever you want. We have no heart. We lost it somewhere. And we have to search for it. Where's the heart? Where is it? Where is it? The Midrash is saying that once the lion was the king of the jungle, also he had one piece of the river, he was in charge, and whoever has to pass has to pay tax, and we have to check his passports. So who was the one to be in charge? The donkey, the chamor. Okay, so he had set of rules. And everybody who came and says, excuse me, passport please. What do you have over here? You have to pay tax. One day, the lion came, the boss, with his small soldiers. And the donkey is a donkey. He said to him, you have to stop, Habibi. He said, why to stop? He says, there is rules. Passport, please. He said, I'm your boss. You fool. He says, I don't care who are you. A rule is a rule. Where is your passport? Open up your luggages. You have to pay tax. This chamor always will stay chamor. So he said to the fox, he got excited, he got upset, he said to the fox, kill this chamor, you know, and prepare him for me for lunchtime. The chutzpan. The fox did what he did. He killed the donkey. And he was preparing all the organs so the lion will come. We're going to have a good lunch. Now when he was working on the body of the donkey, he saw the small heart, you know, red. Tempting. He says, you know, this donkey is so big. If I'll eat a little bit, only the heart, he will not pay attention. Okay. And he went and he ate the heart. Here comes the lion noontime. And he came to eat. He was looking on the body of the donkey, and he's saying, something is missing. He said, what? He says, where is the heart of the donkey? He says, Your Majesty, if he was asking for you to pay tax, did he have a heart, Bechlal? He has no heart. It's a donkey with no heart. Hashem, we don't know what to cry for. You have to excuse me, you know. Usually I say jokes, but not today. Today I have other things on my mind because I told you I owe you twice. So now, do we know how the temple looked? How can you cry for something that you don't know, Bechlal? We're saying, bring the Mashiach. Do you know how he looks? You, Bechlal, going to be able to see him? What are you praying for? The only thing left is to pray for Hashem. Because Hashem is losing so many kids every day. We are all over the world, scattered. How do we look today? How? And every Jew is Hashem's child. Where are they? That's what we have to cry for. Because we're not able to bring the temple back because when a couple starting to fight, do they need a house to live in? Shalom. Go back to your mother. And I'm going back to my parents. And the house, bye-bye. No need a house. That was the relationship between us and Hashem. Hashem says, we don't need this house. First, we have to repair our relationship. I'll tell you a story what the heart means, okay? Pay attention. In Jerusalem, long time ago, they didn't have heat system. In the winter, it's freezing. You know what freezing means? Freezing. That's Jerusalem. It was a shul that people used to come 4 o'clock in the morning for a shiur. At 5 o'clock, they'll pray nets. The shamash was there every day, 4 o'clock in the morning, to prepare them coffee, tea, Turkish coffee, this coffee, any coffee you say, you have it. But he had one sickness, miskin. What? He gave only half a cup, no full cup. They told him, why are you doing this? Our hands are freezing. Bring us a full cup so we can put the hands on the cup. It will melt. We're freezing. Bring us a full cup. He says, talk to the wall. Only half a cup. Ya Habibi, it's only water. Water, put. No. And they called him name, you stingy, you like this, you like that. He said, call me any name you want to. Talk to the wall. Only half. Day in, day out. One day, he became sick. He's ill, now he's old. He cannot come to the shul. He called up his son. He says, my dear son, my Mordechai, come here. I cannot go. I want you to be 4 o'clock in the morning in the shul and you prepare tea and coffee for everybody. Yes, Abba, okay, fine. He came. Everybody was asking him, what are you doing here? Where is the old man? He says, my father don't feel well. He's sick. Today I'm here. I said, Baruch Hashem. He should stay sick. Today, please give us a full cup. He says, no problem, whatever you want, just learn. And he was preparing coffee, tea, green tea, whatever you want. He prepared full cups. He put it on the tray, and he wants to go out. Pitom, he hears steps from the back, and somebody screams, Mordechai! He turns around, his father is there. The son, I told him, Abba, you sick. What are you doing here? He says, I forgot to tell you. Why did you put full cups? Are you normal? Paul, he took the cups, half. He says, why are you doing it? He says, you keep quiet. You listen to your Abba. Only half a cup. He says, I gave him my word. I gave them my word, I'm going to give them full cups. He says, don't pay attention. Only half. He says, but Abba, why? He says, I don't want to tell you. You go and serve only half a cup. Abba, why? Why are you embarrassing me in public? What happened to you? What do you care? It's only water. He saw that the son will not leave him alone. He said, come here, I'll tell you a secret. If you're going to tell it to somebody, I will avoid to you. He said, no, Abba, I promise, I don't say. He says, if you pay attention when you go outside, among the people who are coming to shul, there are two people where their hands are shaking. If I'll give them a full cup, it will spill over the hand and they will get burned. That's why I'm giving everybody only half a cup. The child says, Abba, give them full cup and give two, only half a cup. He says, Ma, which yeshiva did you learn? Right away they will pick up that everybody else is having a full cup and these two, only half a cup because they're handicapped. When the child heard this, now he said, my father is a tzaddik, Behemet. Behemet was a tzaddik. You know why? Because he had a heart. He was caring for people. For every small thing. That's what Hashem wants from us. A lady gave birth in one of the buildings in Eretz Israel. One day before the berit, they put already a name, the parents. They want to call him Yonatan. But something happened in the building. Another child from the floor, from the bottom one, they had a son also called Yonatan, and he passed away 2 days ago. Now they got scared, maybe this name has something to do with the building. So they decided to go to Rav Shlomo Zalman Oyerbach to ask him what to do. Should we call this name or not? The moment they tell him what happened, he says, don't you dare call him Yonatan. Find a different name. And he didn't say why. They went home and they're saying to each other, I knew this name is no good. The student was asking Rav Shlomo Zalman, why you didn't let them call the name that they like? He said to him, pay attention, Habibi. In 3 years from now, the child will grow up and he will go to play outside. His mother will go on the terrace and she says, Yonatan, come home! And the neighbor from the downstairs will hear Yonatan. Again, all her wounds will open again. Every day her wounds are going to be open. You think I will let it happen? Don't call him Yonatan. What a heart. What a heart. That's a Jewish heart. the situation was so bad. The Gemara says that it was the chief of the army of the Jews, his name was Bar de Roma. He was standing on top of the wall, and the enemies threw big stones, like the kotel stones, big ones. That was the artillery there. He stood alone on the wall, and with his foot, he kicked it back to the enemies, and that's how he killed them. But he had one problem. He had no heart. You know why? The Gemara says he was saying to Hashem, don't bother us. Don't interfere. Okay? We can take care of it ourselves. We don't need you. Hashem says, you don't need me? Okay. We'll take care of you. He died like in the bathroom. But then when the enemies came in, listen to this, Rabotai, the Gemara says, in one end of the city, they were killing left and right, Jews. On the other side of the city, the Jews were partying, going to restaurants, and so on and so on. Could you imagine? Could you imagine that in one part of the city people get killed and the other one partying? That was the problem. That's why the distraction is there. If you should come once to my office, I'm giving you one day, not even one week. One day, and I have to call a tzala for you. And you might have to go to the psychiatric in section for LIJ. The thing that I'm hearing all day long from 9 o'clock in the morning until 2 o'clock in the morning, I don't want even to tell you what's going on. I was asking, every person I ask, didn't you love your wife? Not to mention that they don't know b'chlal what love means, but let's put it aside now. Okay? Did you love your wife? He says, of course. Of course. What are you talking about? I say, so what happened? He says, now I don't love her anymore. I say, ah? I didn't know that love is a virus. The same way it comes, the same way it goes. Very nice. Very, very nice. And if you're speaking English, it sounds very good. You know why? You see a person, a zombie. You're asking his friend, what happened to him? He says he fell in love. You know what fell means? He was walking on the street. Unintentionally, he fell. Unintentionally. And the same way it fell, then he went to the hospital. He fixed himself up. And said, I'm not going to fall. Our own homes are destroyed. When Nebuchadnezzar was rejoicing that he destroyed the temple, Yirmiyahu and Navi called him and says, come, Habibi. Why not? Come here. Let me tell you something. He says, why are you rejoicing? Kemach tachun tachanta bayit saruf sarafta. You grinding flour and you burned a house that was already burned. Many of our homes are broken, kids going to the street, they don't know where to go, with Abba, with Imma, one time here, one time there, one time, like a ping pong game. Why? Because people lost their heart. And no heart anymore. A friend of mine, 30 years he didn't have kids. Achusit. 30 years he didn't have kids. His wife was okay, he was okay, fine. IVF, IUI, whatever you want, nothing helped. It was a mystery. What's going on? After 30 years, he's saying to his wife, you know when he said this story? On the Shalom Zachar. He was 52 years old, his wife was 49 years old. The first child they have, his wife was 49 years old. Everybody came to see it. They were expecting 300 people, 1,300 people showed up. Nothing left on the table, nothing. No drinks, no nothing, clue. Pesach. But he said there a story, I'm telling you, I almost fell from my chair. You know what he said? He said, maybe it's a spiritual, something spiritual, maybe I was hurting somebody. And he was starting to rewind the tape. And he says, wow, when I was a bachur in the yeshiva, a lady used to come to clean for us, the yeshiva. She came with her four kids. And the kids were not with a bow tie and everything, you know, say the least. They were jumping all over the place. They turned the yeshiva upside down. So he went, after 10 months, he told her, do us a favor, Bemet. We have to learn, you know. If you can do us a favor, don't bring your kids because they're making noise. She says, I'm a widow and I'm raising these kids by myself. Nobody helps me. Where shall I put them? I have to work. And if the noise is bothering you so much, so alevai in your house, you should never hear screams of kids. He thought that she blessed him. He thought that she told me I'll have kids, but very, very nice, quiet, like Chinese soldiers. Eat, sleep. After 30 years, he says, maybe she cursed me. They found her. And he says, please forgive me. She says, I do. After 10 months, his wife gave birth to a baby boy. The whole neighborhood was on wheels. 49 years old. You cannot hurt no one. The moment you start to hurt somebody, meaning you have no heart. You like the donkey. Exactly. No heart. So let me tell you now. The Gemara that said that in one end of the city they were killing, and in one end of the city they were having a party. Okay? Let me tell you something. Not too far from here, I think it's one block away. Over here we're having a party. And in the Forest Hills High School, there are 1,500 boys and girls that we're going to say bye-bye to them. Who cares? Tell me something, who cares? Do you know what's going on? I heard all the story from the Holocaust and so on. These people went straight to Gan Eden. These people, you know where they're going to go? Are you aware of it? Alevai, if they should reach hell, Alevai. That's as a chut. We gonna let it happen? The community gonna close their eyes, close their ears, and that's it. Because you never saw a mother coming to your office and telling you, my son is going with a Spanish girl. What shall I do? I say, which school did he go? She said, where can he go? Good education. Good education? He can teach you about all drugs that there are there. That's how I learned. I'm an expert. What do you want from the kids? Even the parents don't have heart for their own kids. Money is more important. The house is more important. Yeah? And the kid, high B.O. It's going to be okay. You don't see it. I don't have Bemet every day. How much can I take? How much? And what we gonna do? Let me tell you something. A friend of mine was in Eretz Israel. He saw a person close to 100 years old in late 90s, still in the grocery store, and he has in the front. Also, he sells drinks and this. He by himself. Serving people like a youngster. He told them, what is your secret? What are you eating? He says, what secret? I eat like anybody else. Big deal. He said, did you do something in your life? He said, back in Europe, I think, I'm from Slobodka. It's a city. He said, I saw two kids zooming on the street. They have no school. So I said, kids, why are you on the street? And they said, our parents don't have the money to pay for us. He said, what? So you all day long on the street? He says, yes. He said, come here. He went to the yeshiva. He said, I'm paying. Accept him back. So he said, what was their name? He says, one was Arale. The other one is Yankale. I don't remember the family names. My friend right away started to roll, and he found out that this Arale, he was Rav Aaron Kotler, the Rosh Yeshiva of Lakewood. And now, who is the other one? Who is Yankale? So my friend lives in Mansi. Who lived there? Rav Kamenetsky. You know, sometimes he comes here. His father. He went to him. He told him, you know, somebody told me a story. He says one was Arale and one was Yankale. And you were in Slobodka. Who is the second child? He says, you're looking at him. Rav Yaakov Kamenetsky and Rav Aaron Kotler was saved by a person that he didn't know what he did. Did somebody was in share in Olam Haba? Could you imagine? With few dollars, what did he do? Huh? Two kids that picked up America all the way. And more than that, I'll tell you one day, the Chafetz Chaim called a principal of a school. He said, tell him to come to my house right away, chick-chack. Miss Kenny came on shaking. The Chafetz Chaim called him, what sin did I made already? So the Chafetz Chaim looked at him and he told him, do you remember the name Leibale Bronstein? ring the bell? He says, yes, of course. He was in my yeshiva. I kicked him out. He said to him, is the name Leon Trotsky say something to you? This Leibale Brunstein became Leon Trotsky. And he made so much troubles to the Jews. Huh? I don't want to be in the shoes of this principal. So finally we gathered few people, brave people, and you can say even not normal, and we decided to pull these kids out of every public school that there is. They're even able to bring me into the picture. I have my own plate, you know, full. But I couldn't say no. Now already they took them out. The Chazak have so many programs for them, and they ready to go to yeshiva. Could you imagine? Could you imagine? Who knows whom we're going to save? Who knows? And we need only people that have a heart. Whoever cares, you go to Yaniv from Chazak and tell him, what can I do? I want to participate. Right now, the manpower we have, the funds we're looking for. But we find it. If Hashem wants, we're going to find it. No problem. But who wants to have a share in it? Let me tell you something. Many of the rabbeim in Shaar Etzion was in my yeshiva. No yeshiva wanted them. I said, bring them over. You know? Today they are the best teachers. And they're teaching other kids. I can sleep. I'm just coming to the yeshiva and see what my students came out of Russia not knowing nothing. Today they're turning the school upside down. Who knows how many Chafetz Chaim are zooming in Forest Hills High School. Who knows how many tzedakot we have there? You don't know even. Should we let it go? I'm asking you. Should we let it go? We need everybody's support. The Chazak, they're standing behind all this. They took me. I'm not a youngster anymore. Okay? But I said, Habibi, for this cause, I'm closing my books. What can I do? I will learn from 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't care. But something has to be done. I don't want to be judged that I closed my eyes and I closed my ear. I didn't see. I didn't care. Not me. Do you? Do you? Oy vavoy to you. And this is the children of Hashem that we're saving. Hashem is waiting. Imagine one thing. Did somebody once lost a child only for half an hour in a big store, in the mall? Huh? You're going to lose your mind. 5 minutes, right? I saw once, for half an hour, the kid was lost. Well, in a closed hotel, it was a seminar, it was a Shabbaton, as they call it. We're looking for the child. The mother lost her mind. She thought he was kidnapped and who knows what, and they went to the cameras and so on. The child is not out. He is in the hotel. Finally, they found him behind the piano, sleeping. We're going crazy, and she picked up the child, Miss Kenbier, He was in the sleep. Moshe! I found you. You know how many kids Hashem loses every day? Are you aware of it? On this we have to cry. On Hashem. Every day, a Jew assimilating. Every day somebody is going to the public school, meaning bye-bye Hashem children in the public school. Melech Balchei HaMelachim. His kids are in the public school. What a shame to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. We're going to let it happen? Chas v'shalom. Whoever is going to let it happen, he has no heart. He has no heart. So I'm begging you all. Usually I don't do it. I was never asking for no funds, no gloom. Everything I used to do by myself. That's who I am. But right now, I have to get out of myself, out of all my principles that I always believed in. And we have to get the public, let's get like in the army. Have you been there? I've been there. I fought wars. Yeah, somebody have to say, Kadima, let's go forward. And everybody has to follow. I want to wish you all the best. You should see nachat from your children. Everybody should have a shalom bayit. A real one. We're ready to help there also. Don't hesitate to call me any day, any night. Middle of the night, morning, evening, I'm there. My phone is always on me. Use us. I'm telling you, you can use me. You can make me, you can take me. I don't care. I do not care because I know at the end we're going to see fruits. Everybody should have shalom bayit. And let's get our heart back together. And Emir Tzeh Hashem, next time I'll see you, will be Yerushalayim, which is our place. That's where my parents was born, Jerusalem. So we are Yerushalmis, actually. Bukhari, but Yerushalmi. Okay? So, Bezrat Hashem, I'll meet you there, and we're going to have a very nice party. Okay? Then we can eat. Now we have no time to eat. Now we have to work. Okay, Rabotai, Kol Tov.